Arlene Herson, and I'm glad you can join me because my guest is an extraordinary man who has done everything, and I mean everything, in show business. His credits include singer, actor, musician, composer, arranger, movie star, radio star, television producer, writer, and author. He has even hosted his own television talk show. His talent is legendary. Very few people can do what he does and do them all so well. My guest is Mel Torme. We're here at Michael's Pub in New York City, where he has been getting standing ovations every night. We will meet Mel Torme right after these messages, so please stay right there.
Whoever thought this would happen? Whoever thought a teacher from West Virginia would be teaching a class in Budapest?
Good morning.
But here I am, part of the first Peace Corps team in Eastern Europe. We're here to help Hungarian teachers learn how to teach English. It's an amazing time to be here. For these people, English is the language of opportunity, and they can't get enough of it.
How are you doing today?
Great.
But language isn't the only thing we share. I'm learning Hungarians are a lot like we are. They love their freedom, and they're open to new ideas.
Of freedom, and the government of the people, by the people, for the people, shall not perish from the earth.
We all have a lot of work ahead of us, but I can't think of any job I'd rather have.
Be part of the future with the Peace Corps, the toughest job you'll ever love.
Tonight, Dolores had a few drinks, did some crack, and ended up another tragic story. Only she doesn't know it yet. Drugs make you forget. And if you forget how risky sex can be, you could catch the AIDS virus and not know it for months, even years. AIDS, another way drugs can kill.
You may not think the gas you can save makes a difference, or the amount your whole neighborhood can save, or even your whole town. But when you see how much gas America can save every day, when we all drive just 5 miles per hour slower, it's easy to see how the little bit you can do makes a lot of difference. President Bush hopes you'll do your part. Drive smart.
I'm Arlene Herson. We're at Michael's Pub in New York City, and my very special guest is Mel Torme. And today's a special day for you.
Yeah, sort of. I'm trying not to make it special. I've stopped counting birthdays, Arlene. So it's just another birthday. That's all I can say.
Well, it's a special birthday because you're spending it with me, so it's special for me, too.
Now you've said the magic words.
I'm included in the celebration.
Absolutely.
But I was also here on opening night, when you opened here at Michael's Pub. It was wonderful.
Thank you.
Is it exciting for you still? Is each opening night as thrilling as the first?
Yeah, it really is. I've made a pact with myself that the day that A, I'm not excited about an opening, B, I'm in the middle of an engagement, I walk on the stage, I look around and say to myself, what the hell am I doing here? I don't even like this, is the day I'll quit. I hope that never happens, because right now I'm having literally the time of my life as a singer, performer, and an author, and arranger. But if that ever does happen, I'll quit.
Okay, well, it's never going to happen.
I hope not.
I hope not. At least I know the fans.
From your mouth to God's ears.
Well, because, you know, you're getting better. We're not even good, and you've said it, and there's been lots of, I've done lots of research, we talked about that on you, and it's talking about how your voice has gotten stronger and stronger. I mean, it's always been good, but do you know what I want to do, because it's your birthday today. You've been in show business, we don't have to talk about your age, but you've been in show business more than 60 years.
62 years.
You started when you were...
Four. So now you know how old I am.
Okay, 4 years old.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Tell us how that happened.
Well, my favorite toys as a baby were not necessarily my Lionel trains or my little cast iron cars. They were, quite frankly, my favorite toy in the house was the radio. And I was an inveterate radio listener even as a baby. My mother and dad and my whole family, as a matter of fact, particularly on my dad's side, sang until it came out of your ears. I mean, you drop a hat and 20 people are singing. So it really was environmental. I loved music, I loved singing, and I listened to the radio, and there was a famous name band of the time called the Coon Sanders Orchestra. Carlton Coon was the drummer. Joe Sanders, famous pianist they used to call the old left-hander, was the pianist, and it was a cooperative band, or a joint venture band at least. And I used to listen and listen and listen, and finally one night, to make a long story hopefully painlessly short, my parents took me down there, and these guys are up there playing at the Black Hawk restaurant, by the way, in Chicago, and they're looking down, and here's this little kid singing along with everything they're doing. So at intermission they walked over, they said, "Who's this droll little midget, what's he doing?" And my mother explained that I knew just about every song they did, and they got me up to sing. And you've got to understand that it was a crazy time in America. We're talking 1929. We're talking about the days when guys were flying World War I surplus Jennies under bridges, and people were doing the slide for life from the top of the Chrysler Building, hanging by their teeth. It was a wacky time in this country, and child performers were really very much a part of that particular era. So I went in, I sang, and I became a Monday night feature for $15 every Monday night at the Black Hawk for just under or just over 6 months. And that got me started, and I began to sing with other bands around the town, you know.
But that's incredible. You know, actually, I had read that story, but 4 years old. You've been working ever since. You haven't stopped working.
That's right. That's
You've
true.
Been in show business. You really have done nothing else. Now, here you were at four. From there you went. You had a radio show. Mm-hmm. You were performing with bands. You were working. You were earning money. Mm-hmm. How did that affect you as a child growing up? I mean, how did you relate to other children who were living a normal life?
Pretty well, actually. I went to regular grammar school, regular high school, and by the way, rather tough grammar school in a very tough neighborhood. And consequently, I mean, it was the Depression. You know, we were all fighting that devil, that hydra-headed monster called Depression. So the truth of the matter was that I grew up very normally. A lot of the kids in my class resented the fact that many days I'd have to be excused at noon to go downtown to the Loop of Chicago and to work either on NBC or CBS or ABC or even on Independent, doing those many, 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 I lost track of all the soap operas and kids shows that I did. But within the course of, say, 7 to 8 years, I did virtually every show that ever emanated out of Chicago, including Jack Armstrong and Little Orphan Annie, Captain Midnight, and all the soap operas, the story of Helen Trent and Mary Noble, Backstage Wife. I did every one of those.
Incredible. Okay. Did you have any training? Did you just do this on your own, or did you have help?
My training was the fact, really, that, again, we were all rabid radio listeners. My dad and my two uncles, my Uncle Art, my Uncle Al, were obsessive moviegoers. And we went to the movies even during the Depression days. They found the money to go to the movies anywhere from 3 to 5 times a week. They loved the movies. And of course, I became a movie fanatic. I still am, by the way. And so I think the training really came principally from watching the Cagneys and the Mickey Rooneys and Jackie Coopers and people like that act upon the screen.
You know, it's funny because then, not too long after, you got to go to Hollywood and you got to be on the screen with a lot of these people. But before then, you also, because there's so much that you do, you write songs. Your first song, 16, called Lament to Love.
Lament to Love, yeah.
Now, you were 16 years old.
What did I know?
What did you know? What did you know? Why did you
know?
What
was the... You know, everything is relative, and you can have a very intense feeling for a girl at 16 that goes to the same high school you do, and people, at least in those days, used to shrug and say, "Oh, punk little squirt, love, come on," you know. Of course, it wasn't love, but it was puppy love. And when that girl chose to not particularly favor me with her presence and her company and her kisses, I wrote this song called Lament to Love. And we got it to Harry James, He had a wonderful band in those days. And he recorded it, and it got on the hit parade. And all of a sudden, there I was, this little squirt from Hyde Park High School in Chicago, having the distinction, at least at that moment, of being literally the youngest songwriter ever to be on the hit parade. And it wasn't on long. I think it was on for about 4 weeks. But boy, they were a glorious 4 weeks for me. Suddenly, a lot of girls in high school found me irresistible.
Okay, but what about this particular girl?
No, as a matter of fact, she went on to become an air stewardess for United. And funnily enough, after I'd become fairly well known, actually in 1947, after I played the Copacabana here and people were playing my records and things, you know, I was getting to be kind of a household commodity. I played Denver, and she was based in Denver, and she came to see me, and she sat with me, and she was still a very pretty woman. But I kind of looked at her and thought, what did I ever see in this? How can I have written that song for this girl? But at the time, I did.
Okay, we're going to take a break now, and then we're going to come back and talk some more.
Love it.
We're at Michael's Pub with Mel Torme. We'll be right back after these messages.
Tony had some drinks, a few joints, and got into a fatal accident tonight. Only he doesn't know it yet. Drugs make you forget. And if you forget how risky sex can be, you could catch the AIDS virus and not know it for months, even years. AIDS, another way drugs can kill.
Wake up all the teachers, time to teach a new way. Maybe then they'll listen to what you have to say.
The power of teaching.
The world won't get no better.
The power to wake up young minds. The power to wake up the world. Teachers have that power. Reach for the power. Teach. I'm Edward James Olmos, and we're recruiting new teachers. Call 1-800-45-TEACH.
I never saw anybody light up a bar like Jack.
You can say that again.
And a million jokes.
2 million.
Oh, what a riot.
Oh, yeah.
One of a kind.
No kidding.
I swear, if I thought he couldn't drive, I'd have said something, you know? I mean, how could you spoil his fun?
Right.
Take the keys, call a cab, take a stand. Friends don't let friends drive drunk.
If you're an employer, we know how tough it is when your National Guard and Reserve employees are gone. But it's even tougher for them. Be a hero. Give your employees the freedom to protect ours.
I'm Arlene Herson. We're at Michael's Pub with Mel Torme. You know, it happened for you so quickly. 4 years old, working ever since, busier than ever. But when it started in the beginning, at 16 years old, you've had so many special big breaks. First big break, on the road with a band, Chico Marx.
I'm not sure that was a big break, though, Arlene. I mean, it was a work in progress. It was, you know, getting to do something that I wanted to do, which was to work with a band, to write arrangements for the band. I didn't write for the band, I only wrote for a vocal group in the band. I put together a vocal group out of the band to sing and eventually to be the drummer in the band, which I was. So it was a great year of experience. I really kind of counted what happened afterward by going out to Hollywood. I'd been discovered by an RKO talent scout, and he put me in a movie called Higher and Higher with Frank Sinatra, by the way. And that was really, really the first sort of really major break in my career.
Okay, but it all started along the way. I mean, here you were 16 with a band. When you mentioned that you were a drummer, which I'm sure you are almost as famous for being a drummer as you are a singer. I was here opening night. I heard
in
you
some
play
quarters.
The drums. You are wonderful. I mean, for those that only know you as a singer, I have to say you are wonderful as a drummer.
Thank you.
But here you were 16 years old on the road with a band. Taken away from home, you're very close with your parents, wonderful thing. How personally was that for you?
I loved it. I know you'd like me to say, gee, I missed Mom and Dad terribly, golly. I did, actually, because I'm very family-oriented. But it's something that I had worked toward, and really very badly wanted. See, the bands were the high visibility in those days. Literally, singers hadn't come into their own until Sinatra left Tommy Dorsey's band and struck out on his own. And of course, by that time, he almost single-handedly, and as a matter of fact, I will say single-handedly, created a niche for singers in which the bands became sort of secondary visibility. But up until then, the bands were it for me, and I used to listen to the records and play drums along with the great records of Benny Goodman and Artie Shaw and Duke Ellington and Count Basie every day when I came home from high school. So being with a band was to me the optimum way to live your life. And that year was tremendous fun. I really enjoyed it.
Yeah, okay. But I read that you had said that in the early days that you had fits of depression because you felt that you weren't good enough, that your voice wasn't good enough, that you weren't going to make a...
Absolutely. Absolutely. And as a matter of fact, it went beyond the band. When I started recording as a solo artist in 1947, and I made tons of records, I was really rather naughty about some of them. I'd come into a DJ's studio and he'd say, "Hi, Mel, we've got your latest record." And I'd say, "Oh, that?" And I'd pick it up and break it over the table and pay him for the record. I mean, I got to the point where guys would say, "Don't let him have any of the records." Because I did think that the singing was puerile. I hated it. And I just couldn't wait to work on, you want to call it an art or a craft. I think it's a craft, not an art. Singing to me is a craft. I couldn't wait to work on it and try to improve it and get it to be more palatable to my ear. And then finally I got to a point, but it took a long, long time, Arlene, where I could finally say, it's not bad, this is okay, I can live with this, you know. But you'd be amazed how recent that experience is.
That's interesting.
Yeah, absolutely.
That's interesting. So, but it's okay now.
Well, it's okay. It's not what I'd like it to be. And I will go to my grave undoubtedly saying, gee, I wish I'd done that once more. I wish that could have been better. I wish I sounded better.
Now we're taking you back to Hollywood because you mentioned first movie, Frank Sinatra, Higher and Higher. Mm-hmm. Not bad way to start.
Yeah.
What was, but we've heard horror stories. Judy Garland, who you wrote a book about and we'll talk about more later. But, I mean, we heard how terrible, it may have been glamorous life, but we heard that it was a terrible life. You were mistreated as a child actor. Was that true?
It actually stemmed from that song you talked about, Lament to Love, because I was supposed to go with Harry James' band as a singer and a drummer. He discovered me when I brought that song to him. And I have, it's funny, I looked at it just the other day, I have a sheaf of letters from Harry James and from his band manager, Don Reed, saying, "We're trying to work it out. We want Mel to come with the band. Harry would like to put him under a personal management contract." It was all there. But the kids in my high school didn't believe me. My best friend, John Poister, who lives in this town, is still one of my great friends. He was with the school newspaper. He told everybody when I told him, "Don't do it until I got the contract." So he told everybody, and all of a sudden, they all got excited that one of their schoolmates was going to be a Harry James band member. P.S., it never worked out. I never went with the band. And then I was branded a liar. And it was an extremely difficult time. You ask me, Arlene, well, how did you feel going on the road? One of the main hunks of euphoria going with the Chico Marx band was to get away from that school. Because, of course, some people were greatly loyal, and I love them to this day. But an enormous amount of student body turned against me. Now, I'm not sitting here going, "Oh, poor little Mel, too bad." The truth of the matter is, it's human nature. It seemed to them that I was a liar, that I was never really going to go with Harry James, okay? And when John Poister said, "But you've got all these letters, just bring them to school," I said, "No, because that's not really a test of friendship."
You know, but I read about that actually in your book. It wasn't all velvet.
Mm-hmm.
And you didn't bring it to school. And
no.
And later it was proven, you know, but you got beaten up. You were treated miserably. It would have been so easy for you just to say, hey guys, I'm telling the truth? You know, why were you standing on ceremony?
Because I prize loyalty. I really do. I think, and I don't say this lightly, I think I'm one of the most loyal people as a friend in the world. I prize it in people. And the way you find out about friends is when you're in the midst of adversity. I found out who my friends really were when I was divorced from my English actress wife, Janet Scott. And the people who rallied around me and saved my life, and I don't mind telling you they did, including my wife, Allie, who at that point was a brand new friend that I just met. I treasure those people. I'll treasure them the rest of my life.
Yeah, actually, we have to take a break, but all of those high school students saw you on the screen, and they actually, there have been a couple of marriages, so we're going to talk about that. We're going to take a break.
Okay.
We're speaking with Mel Torme here at Michael's Pub. We'll be right back after these messages.
The tragedy of child abuse takes many forms, from verbal assaults to hurtful blows. But it is preventable, and we all have a role to play. If you know of a parent having difficulty, reach out, sit down and talk. And if you're having difficulty, get help for yourself. Talk to a friend. Sign up for a parenting class. Take time out. Don't take it out on your child.
Contact the National Committee for Prevention of Child Abuse.
I want to be a doctor.
A judge.
Electrical engineer.
A chemist.
A dentist.
The American dream is alive, nurtured in part by the United Negro College Fund. The fund reaches out to deserving students with a quality education, an education that turns wonderful young dreams into realities.
I want to be president.
And you'll be tough to beat.
Please support the United Negro College Fund.
Gosh, Darlene, it sure is amazing how much we have in common.
I know, Larry. We both love three-car pileups. We both were built in Buffalo.
And we both know wearing safety belts helps save thousands of lives.
Yeah, this is fascinating.
Don't mind Vince. He's getting over a bad breakup.
I know. Janet's picking up the pieces, too. They're in here.
I wish they understood it's all worth it to get people to buckle up.
Hey, lacerated lovebirds, I sense a major crush.
You could learn a lot from a dummy. Buckle your safety belt.
Talk about head over heels.
I'm Arlene Herson. We're here at Michael's Pub with Mel Torme. And before the break, we said we were going to talk about, because you've been married four times now, to Allie, who's wonderful. Mm. But you know, before we get to the present wife and all that, I want to still go back, because you've been a ladies' man for a long time. Now, you have been, in your life, have been people like Marilyn Monroe, mm-hmm. but a real romance with Ava Gardner, mm-hmm. when you were both in the movies.
That's right. Actually, that began really at just before New Year's of 1946. And it wasn't a giant romance, but it did last for about 3 months.
You know, it's funny because you also have written several books. And one of the books is a novel called mm-hmm. Winner. Well, mm-hmm. I happen to have it here. We have all these books here, but one is called Winner. Now, in this book with Winner, because it's funny, because it's fiction, mm-hmm. but you talk about a woman. Now, there's a real-life story with Ava Gardner. Now, there's also fiction. Now, we're a family show, so I wonder how you can get that story of Ava Gardner and the fictional lady in the book having lunch with her in the commissary, and somebody... Now, it's a family show. Can we do it?
Well, yeah, it's just that... A very well-known, as a matter of fact, I don't think he'd mind because he's an angel of a man, Peter Shaw, who's married to Angela Lansbury and has been for a long, long time. They've had a great, long-standing, one of the best in Hollywood ever. And they're two dear people. I love them both. But at the time, he was an aspiring young English actor looking around the commissary, seeing this gorgeous woman sitting at a table. And I had met him briefly, and he walked over to me and greeted me as if we had been long lost friends, and I was rather taken aback. And then Peggy Maley was a great friend of Ava's. She was sitting at the table. The three of us were having lunch, and he said hello to me, and he just dismissed Peggy, and he turned to Ava and began to get very, very flowery in his speech. You're certainly the most gorgeous female creature I've ever seen in my life, blah, blah. And he went on, and Ava just kept eating her soup. And finally, she looked up and said something that is utterly unprintable or untalkable on not only a family show, on any show. And the poor guy he went crimson. I really felt sorry for him, and Ava had quite a mouth on her. And he stammered and walked away, and she just said, well, throwing all that garbage at me, he deserved it. And actually, they became great friends, you know, because Peter was at the studio. It's just an anecdote from Hollywood life.
Okay, well, that story was in Winner. Now, mm-hmm. Winner was your novel. Now, you have said that writing Winner really saved your life. You were going through a very difficult time during that time. But how much of Winner, it's a man who's a singer with a band, mm-hmm. how much of Winner is real life?
Very little, really. The truth is that Winner is a Polish-Irish American. Doesn't look anything like me. Or, as a matter of fact, anybody else. A lot of people thought it was either me or Sinatra. And it absolutely isn't. It's purely out of whole cloth. However, the fiction that I love to read is fiction that's occasionally laced with truthful incidents that have happened. And it gives it a kind of a veracity, you know? So that there are a few incidents in Winter that are taken from real life.
There are a couple that I wonder about. And one, in Winter, your best friend is someone named Bitsy Munro, mm-hmm. A black drummer, mm-hmm. who you were very supportive of, who you went to bat for. But in the book, Bitsy becomes very well known.
Famous, megastar.
Right, yeah. And snubs you. Is that based on a real life person?
Yeah, it's based on a couple of people. I mean, I've never really been very vocal about this, but truthfully, it is based on Sammy Davis Jr. and on Buddy Rich. It's kind of a combination. Yeah.
That's interesting because Buddy Rich became your best friend.
Absolutely.
You wrote another book, as a matter of fact. We have your most recent book, which is called Traps, which is the life of Buddy Rich. Mm-hmm. And you know, it's very interesting because in this book, he did some very hurtful things to you.
Yeah, but you know something, Arlene? It's a little bit like a marriage. When there's a really close friendship, and I'm talking about Sammy and Buddy, we've all been tight, we've all been close for years and years and years. And so occasionally you have disagreements, and you get back together. We always did.
Do you know, I'm going to have a disagreement right now because I cannot believe this. We're out of time. Now, you have promised it's your birthday, you're going to give me a present. You have promised that you're going to come back.
Absolutely.
Next week.
Love it.
And this is going to be the continuing story of Mel Torme here at Michael's Pub.
Okay.
We're speaking to Mel Torme. We've just barely touched the surface, so please come back next week and we'll talk some more. Meantime, good night. Hope to see you then. Arlene Herson, and we're here at Michael's Pub in New York City. My guest is Mel Torme. Mel was with us last week, but it is impossible to tell you all about this incredibly talented man in just one show. Mel is back with us this week to share with us his remarkable career as a singer, actor, musician, composer, producer, and writer. Believe it or not, he also flies his own airplane. An exceptional man with an extraordinary life. My guest is Mel Torme, and we'll meet him right after these messages.
Lyme disease is transmitted by a tick the size of a pinhead, which can attack during a walk in the woods or a park or even in your own backyard. But tick bites can be prevented, and the disease can often be successfully treated, especially in the early stages. The Will Rogers Institute is offering a free booklet to help you learn about Lyme disease. It tells how to recognize the symptoms and the best ways to reduce your chances of getting it. For your free copy, write the Will Rogers Institute, White Plains, New York.
A message from Ken McFeely, a police officer in New York City for 19 years. He was so respected, he was elected president of the Patrolman's Benevolent Association.
My name is Ken McFeely. Right now, I'm living under a death sentence. The doctors tell me that I have maybe 5 or 6 weeks to go because I have lung cancer caused by smoking. The danger that threatened my life as a policeman was sitting in that radio car and lighting up that cigarette. I'm 47 years old, and I'll never see 48. You face more danger with the 20 cigarettes that are in your pocket than any 6 bullets in somebody's gun. Cigarettes are a time bomb that you plant in your own life that explodes 20 or 30 years later. And you know something? You can stop it if you stop smoking now.
Ken recorded this message for other smokers to hear before he died in October 1986.
Thousands of forest fires are started by people who never realize what they've done. Some never even set foot in the forest.
I'm Arlene Herson. We're at Michael's Pub with Mel Torme for the second time around. Mm-hmm. And I thank you very much because I know how busy you are.
Oh, this is a pleasure.
Okay, here at Michael's Pub, where you are all month and where I have been hearing dynamite things, and I personally was here opening night, mm-hmm. but I understand also this year there's a record. In addition to Michael's Pub, Carnegie Hall. 3 times in 1 year. I don't think anybody has ever done that.
Well, they may have, but I don't know about it, and I'm just thrilled to death that I'm welcome at Carnegie Hall 3 times in 1 year. It's very exciting.
Well, welcome at Carnegie Hall. You're welcome all over the world. And there is so much that we mentioned earlier in the show that you do, that you have done, and that you're still doing. And one of the things that I don't know if people are really aware of what a prolific writer you are, how many books that you've written. We were talking at the end of the last show about your most recent book, mm-hmm. which I have right here, uh-huh. which is called Traps, The Drum Wonder, mm-hmm. okay, based on the life of your very best friend.
Buddy Rich.
Buddy Rich. Mm-hmm. Your very best friend, but also somebody who treated you at times terribly.
Well, I wasn't alone, Arlene. Buddy was occasionally an alienator, and he had a very complex personality. I kind of understood it. There were times when I really couldn't suffer it, to the point where there were periods when we didn't talk to each other for 2 and 3 years at a time. But we always got back together. We were like family. And as a matter of fact, one of the reasons I wrote this book was because Buddy said directly to me, "You know me better than anyone except for perhaps my immediate family. So you're the guy to write this book." So it was, you could call it an authorized biography.
But you know, it's interesting because he started, and it's a fascinating book, by the way, and I recommend it, but he started performing at 18 months old, which I wouldn't have known if I didn't read this book. Mm-hmm. You started performing at 4 years old. Mm-hmm. You waited a much longer.
I sponged off the folks for a few more years.
Okay, but I mean, there you were both, I mean, working professionally, being paid, on stage, working regularly. Was that something that bound the two of you, the fact that you both started and as so young and show business was part of your life for so long?
I think it was. As a matter of fact, I think it's one of the reasons that Sammy Davis and Buddy and I, Mickey Rooney and Jackie Cooper, a lot of us who were great friends, were friends because there was a kinship based on our very early beginnings in show business.
Why did you write this book? I mean, he asked you to write it. I understand that. But in terms of you writing about your friend and writing about the difficulties that he went through, because he had a very strange life.
Tough life, yeah.
How did you feel about that?
Well, I had great empathy and sympathy for Buddy, and I also occasionally had great ire about Buddy. The point is that he was really one of a kind. There's never, ever been a drummer like Buddy Rich, and I wager that there'll never be one like him again. He was really a natural. He was like the Edison of drummers. He seemed to hold the original patent on drumming, the original blueprints on playing the drums. So he was extraordinary. It isn't just like picking a drummer out of the blue, friend or not, Arlene, and saying, gee, I think I'll write a book about that guy. And I'm sure there are a lot of interesting lives among drummers and other musicians that I could have written about. But Buddy and I were very close, and he did ask me to write this.
That's it. And you were a drummer, too. You are a drummer. I heard you play drums the other night, as I mentioned in the first show, and you are a wonderful drummer.
Thank you.
As a matter of fact, in this book, there is a picture of you, Gene Krupa, and Buddy Rich. I mean, three greats playing drums together.
Yeah, we did that on a special that we did out of Toronto, Canada, around 1970 or 71.
That must have been a thrill for you.
It was thrilling.
Okay, I also have, for Buddy Rich, here, Together Again for the First Time. Mm-hmm. The two of you did an album together. Mm-hmm. Now, it's called Together Again for the First Time.
Well, I'll tell you why, because people constantly would come up to both of us, since we were such great friends and everybody knew we were, and would say, gee, we've got your album. And Buddy would say, what are you talking about? We've never recorded together. That's the way he used to talk. Or somebody would say it to me, and I'd say, look, thank you very much. I'm sure you saw us somewhere together appearing, but we've never recorded together. Finally, we kind of made a pact that we would make an album, finally, and dispel all of this, and we thought that a very natural title would be Together Again. For the first time.
Okay, I've been listening to the songs, as a matter of fact. It's wonderful. He also had a wonderful sense of humor, played some practical jokes on you.
Phenomenal. He played one practical joke on me that I'll never forget. When we were appearing together, I think it was at the University of Michigan, and just before I was to walk on the stage, and he was standing right next to me, he tapped me, and as I turned, he took a bottle of blue-black ink and threw it all over my tuxedo shirt. Well, I was in shock. And now the guy's saying, here he is, Mel Torme, and I had to go out. So I walked to the microphone and I stopped the band who were playing my introduction. I said, ladies and gentlemen, listen, I owe you an apology. I hate to appear like this, but I have this crazy friend, Buddy Rich, back there. And I looked, and it was perfectly white. He'd used disappearing ink on me. Now, see, I think that's a very funny. I laughed harder than anybody.
Funny.
You know, I thought it was great.
That's
he was a prankster. He loved pranks.
That's great. We have to disappear for a couple of minutes now, because we're going to take a break. We're speaking with Mel Torme here at Michael's Pub in New York City. We'll be right back after these messages.
Vince, come on, we're late.
This headbang is more fun than going through a windshield.
From Iron Maiden, drive home safe. Remember to strap yourselves in with your safety belts. You don't want to end up like Eddie. Belt up. Don't be a dummy.
There is a mighty spirit shining out.
In Salisbury, Maryland, the hungry are being fed. In Wind Falls, Indiana, a man who learned to read at 47 is making sure others learn earlier. In Hope, New Mexico, people turned an abandoned school into a thriving community center. In Boston, Massachusetts, neighbors set up a crime hotline that's making their streets safer. From Seattle to Galveston, from Buffalo to Fargo, every day, someone in America is doing something to light up another life. But there is so much more to do. The light to do it is within us all. We only need to share it. Contact the Points of Light Foundation. Do something good. Feel something real.
Ready! When your employees train with the National Guard and Reserve, they learn to be better team players, better decision makers, and better leaders. It's training that makes them better at serving our country. And better when they come back to work for you.
Bill's back.
Be a hero. Give your employees the freedom to protect ours.
We're here at Michael's Pub and with my very special guest, Mel Torme. Yeah, we've been talking about your books and you're an author, but you really are best known for being a singer. I mean, a magician, arranger, and all the other things that you've done. But when you started out and when you came to New York, you were labeled. You had something that every time I mentioned Mel Torme to a certain age group, they say,
the Velvet Fog.
Okay, now, but they don't know it, and I didn't know it until just yesterday, that you hated being called the Velvet Fog.
I really did, and as a matter of fact, never has been a contract ever issued on me for any engagement I've ever played that said, and don't forget, use his sobriquet, his nickname, the Velvet Fog. It just stuck like glue, and people just apparently wanted to use it and thought of me that way. I got a little abusive about it and a little stupid about it, and finally my wife, Allie, said, you know, a lot of people think about that with great affection. They grew up with you, and you were the Velvet Fog, and I said, you know, you're right, I'm going to stop being churlish about this, and I have stopped, so that when people say, hi, hey, Fog, how you doing? Great, good to see you, you know. And we leave it at that.
Okay, but now for those of you who are listening to this show, you know that Mel Torme does not like to be called the Velvet Fog. Okay, if you were, now this probably isn't fair, but if you were going to pick a name for yourself, what would you pick?
I wouldn't pick a name, because I really don't like labels, Arlene. I think that not so much the Velvet Fog, but the fact that it is a label. It has a gimmicky quality, and you've seen me perform, and I think you know that I don't rely on gimmicks. So I would really just like to be, I mean, even when, and this has happened to me again and again and again, and I'm very grateful for it, don't get me wrong. I don't want to appear to be discontented about the fact that writers have written about me as the singer's singer, or the singer's musician, or the musician's singer. You know, you want to juxtapose and play around with them. But that's very flattering. I really just like to be known as myself, a working singer, a guy that really works at it and tries and cares about it.
Yeah, and the name Mel Torme is pretty good and sticks to you pretty good. Do you ever get stage fright?
No, I never have.
Never.
And as a matter of fact, I've wondered about that, and I've thought to myself that there's perhaps something missing in me. The fact that on any given occasion I can remember, including first time at Carnegie Hall, first time in the Hollywood Bowl, I've now played those two venues 15 consecutive years, started in 76. And they're wonderful, but you know, you think about all the people out there, and particularly in the case of Carnegie Hall and the Bowl, a lot of celebrities out there. This last Hollywood Bowl date that I did, Charlton Heston was there with his wife Lydia, and Dom DeLuise, a whole bunch of people were out there to see me. And it could be daunting, but the truth is, it's what I do for a living, and I love doing it, and consequently, I don't even think about that. I just think about, I hope to God I can remember all these words, and I hope I acquit myself well, you know.
Okay, I have heard that you never sing the same song the same way twice.
I think that's true, yeah.
How do you change it?
Well, because I really do operate within the so-called parameters of the jazz genre, and jazz singers in general are jazz singers by virtue of the fact that they can extemporize on any given melody or set of chord changes, sometimes even lyrically. I know Ella does that all the time, and she's marvelous. So that, from that standpoint, from my jazz leanings, I don't sing any song the same way twice.
In singing, one of the things that you can't possibly sing the same way twice, because I don't even understand what you're saying when you do it, but you've become very well known for scat singing. Now, how, and that's very difficult, I understand. I mean, it looks easy, but I understand that's very difficult.
It is difficult, mainly because it is the alter ego to, let us say, a Dizzy Gillespie or Benny Goodman or somebody like that playing their instrument. They have a little bit of an edge on that kind of extemporizing because the instrument will play itself in tune, usually. I mean, you still have to work at it. But a voice, you really have to think all the time about singing these little scat things directly in tune, or they're not very pleasant to listen to. So it is a little, I think it's a little tougher. I really do.
Yeah, it was funny. With all the things that you do, one weekend I was reading your autobiography, and I turned on the television set, and there you were, by the way, on the telethon with Jerry Lewis, yeah. Scat singing.
Successful.
I mean, here at Michael's Pub, people are coming every night and they are raving. The reviews are wonderful. Carnegie Hall, we mentioned three times this year. Mm-hmm. But there was a time when rock and roll came in, when Mel Torme's life really changed.
Yeah, it really did. It almost changed totally because when the great incursion of rock happened, the initial incursion, I got so disgusted with music and with the music business and bookers and agents and, you know, that I began to haunt ground schools, aviation ground schools, and thought that I would perhaps totally change careers and become a commercial pilot. And as I said, I really pursued it rather heavily for at least a couple of months, maybe a few months. But wiser heads in mind said, look, the pendulum is over there. It will swing. It always does. It'll come back, and just you got to hang in there. And they were wiser heads than mine, and I resisted becoming a pilot, and I am a pilot, but just a private pilot.
It's interesting that you say that, because the way you became a pilot is also a very important part of your life. We're going to take a break, because I want to talk about that.
All right.
When we come back. Now, Mel Torme, the pilot, the flyer,
okay.
We'll be right back after these messages. We're with Mel Torme here at Michael's Pub in New York City.
Honey, it's Mom. Please let me in. I'm worried.
Learn to see the signs of mental illness. 2 out of 3 people who get help get better. For a free booklet, call the American Mental Health Fund.
Every day, we're losing 50,000 barrels of oil, over 2 million gallons of gasoline, to a seemingly unimportant thing. Low tire pressure. Have you checked yours lately? President Bush hopes you'll do your part. Drive smart.
This doesn't scare you. Just wait.
The doctor will see you now.
One night a year ago, Vanessa got high with some guy and forgot everything she learned about preventing AIDS. Now her life is the horror show. AIDS. Another way drugs can kill.
I'm Arlene Herson, and we're with Mel Torme here at Michael's Pub in New York City, where we are sitting and having a wonderful conversation. But however, you spend time, I'm relaxing here, but you have spent time relaxing. We mentioned earlier you fly your own plane.
I used to. I haven't flown for quite a while now, Arlene, because my eyes aren't terribly good anymore. But I did love becoming a private pilot, and I became a private pilot in March, I believe, of 1964, and did quite a bit of flying across the country in my own airplane. A lot of fun, very enjoyable, and so unakin to showbiz. I mean, it's a totally removed from show business, except to use the microphone and say this is Cherokee 889 or 8 whiskey on a downwind, you know. But I did enjoy it. I loved the image of it. I loved being a pilot.
You know, it's funny because I have been learning a lot about Mel Torme. Now, in addition, we mentioned all the things you do. You write books. One of your books that you wrote a while ago that's recently re-released, The mm-hmm. Other Side of the Rainbow, about Judy Garland. But in reading about this book with Judy Garland, I learned a lot about Mel Torme. Mm-hmm. In this book, I learned that you were terrified of flying.
It's true.
Before.
Yeah.
So what happened that changed you?
You know, it's like loving the looks of a beautiful woman but saying, I don't want to get near her because she's trouble. I loved airplanes, but I was afraid of flying. What changed me was a drastic situation that came up in my life. My second wife and I broke up, and I knew we were going to go through a hellacious divorce. And I went up to San Jose to appear in the nightclub there, and I woke up the next morning not realizing it, and I heard sputtering sounds, looked out the window, and the hotel, the motel that I was staying in, was literally on 3-1 right, I guess it was, of San Jose Airport. And here were these little planes coming in, and I said, okay, that's it. I'm going to become a private pilot this week. Now, maybe it was a death wish. I don't know. But I must say I had a great time learning, and the flying that I've done has been wildly enjoyable.
You know, it's interesting when you say a death wish, because it was really like a life wish, because it really turned you around completely, gave you something positive to look through. You had written this book at that time during a very difficult time. Mm-hmm. I mean, not only were you having a difficult time personally, but working with Judy Garland sounded like it was absolutely a mind-boggling from an emotional point of view.
It was, Arlene. It was also very inspirational. You know, it depended on which show we were doing. As I said in my book about Judy, when she really respected and admired a specific guest star, she'd come in and learn all the material, she'd be there on time, and she would turn in a devastatingly wonderful performance. But there were times when she felt that the guest stars were frankly beneath her, and incidentally they were a lot of times, from a standpoint of importance, of image, you know, of pecking order in the business. And on those occasions, it was difficult writing that show. It was not the happiest thing in the world.
Well, when you say difficult writing that show, at first you didn't want to take the job because you mm-hmm. felt it was beneath you.
Yep, that's true.
When you took the job, were you happy?
Well, happiness is a relative thing where we're talking about writing the Judy Garland show. I took the job because that marriage that I just mentioned was crumbling. It was just coming apart at the seams. And I felt that probably part of the problem was being on the road as much as I was. I thought if I could come into Hollywood and go to an office every day, and even though it was, to me, somewhat demeaning, to go and write for Judy Garland, which after all in itself is kind of an honor, in my opinion, that maybe I could save the marriage. Well, it was very foolish. The marriage was dead, and as I say, it was a terminally ill marriage, even at that point. But it was worth a try.
Okay, that was your second marriage.
Yes.
At that time.
Mm-hmm.
Was Judy a friend?
Yeah, she was. She was a friend, and it broke my heart that the relationship corroded, mainly because of money. She just didn't want to pay. We'd squandered a lot of money on this series. Consequently, when it got down toward the end, David Beagleman and Freddie Fields, her managers, said, now look, Judy, we've only got a couple of shows left. If you want to realize anything out of these, maybe we better fire everybody. And I mean, she just did concert shows at the end. There was just the orchestra and Judy. And of course, at $140,000 a pop for those shows, I guess she put some money away. But she didn't want to pay me for my final duties on the show, and she finally fired me, I think, two shows from the end. And I had to go after her and sue her. And I did. And then at one point, we saw each other in a lawyer's office, and I looked at her and I said, I can't do this.
Okay, you can't, and you didn't sue her.
No, I did not.
When you look back on Judy, because I understand that Liza and Lorna, her children read the book, mm-hmm. that Lorna hated it, Liza hated it, but then I think she came around
Liza and I are great
and realized, when you think of Judy Garland, What do you remember?
I remember a lot of great vulnerability, which we all know about her. She was extremely vulnerable. She had been exploited terribly at MGM in her early years. A lot of people say, well, so what? She became a movie star and world famous. Well, that's easy enough to say, but when you're a young kid growing up and you're called upon after a whole day's work to go out to Pasadena to open up a supermarket and cut the ribbon, that's pretty tough stuff. And that did happen to her a lot at MGM. So she began taking uppers and downers to go to sleep, to wake up, and that began Judy's dependency. I never blamed her for it at all, and I did love her. And those times when she sang her heart out, I'll tell you, there was nothing quite like it. It was absolutely thrilling.
You know, she was a thrilling performer. You are a thrilling performer. Your life has been extraordinary. You mentioned something earlier, and I didn't pick up on it only because it's so far into the show, but you mentioned the problems with your marriage. Now, mm-hmm. having the kind of life that you have, being on the road all the time, I wonder, you know, whether is it possible to have a normal life at home with a marriage?
I do now.
You do now? Well,
yeah. Yeah, it took, you know, I like to keep saying I did it till I got it right. But I've been married to Allie now. We've been together for almost 16 years. And we've been married for 7 of those 16 years. And I must say that it's just a glorious, glorious marriage. Allie is a lawyer. She is a CPA. I mean, she is really an extraordinary woman. And she understands the vicissitudes of the road and being on the road and not being together. And she's handled that brilliantly. I would venture to say that it's one of the best marriages in Hollywood. No kidding.
Wow. Well, you've been very lucky, and I've been very lucky in having you here as a guest on my show, because it really has been extraordinary for me learning all about you. We have your album, Together Again. When we go out, I want to play some of this, and I want our audience to get to know some of Mel Torme with Buddy Rich. Together Again for the first time. I'm glad you've been together again with me for the second time.
Me too.
And I hope that you have all enjoyed getting to know Mel Torme, and I hope that you'll join me again next week. Meantime, good night. Hope to see you then. And I'm glad that you can join me tonight. We're here at Michael's Pub in New York City. My very special guest is Mel Torme. You all know Mel Torme is a singer, but he's also an actor, a composer, a musician, an author. He's going to share with us what the personal side of being such a superstar is. Although he doesn't like to be called a superstar, I think he's a superstar, and I think he's a wonderful man. So please join us. My special guest is Mel Torme. We'll be right back after these messages.
From Iron Maiden, drive home safe. Remember to strap yourselves in with your safety belts. You don't want to end up like Eddie.
Belt up. Don't be a dummy.
There is a mighty spirit. being fed. In Wind Falls, Indiana, a man who learned to read at 47 is making sure others learn earlier. In Hope, New Mexico, people turned an abandoned school into a thriving community center. In Boston, Massachusetts, neighbors set up a crime hotline that's making their streets safer. From Seattle to Galveston, from Buffalo to Fargo, every day, someone in America is doing something to light up another life. But there is so much more to do. The light to do it is within us all. We only need to share it. Contact the Points of Light Foundation. Do something good. Feel something real.
When your employees train with the National Guard and Reserve, they learn to be better team players, better decision makers, and better leaders. It's training that makes them better at serving our country. And better when they come back to work for you.
Bill's back.
Be a hero. Give your employees the freedom to protect ours.
I'm Arlene Herson. We're here at Michael's Pub in New York City with Mel Torme. And I thank you very much for being here because I know how busy you are, and I also know what a difficult life it is for a performer. You've been in this business for a very, very long time. You've sustained, you're doing wonderfully. But personally, I wonder what kind of, you know, how it affects you from a personal point of view.
Well, from my personal life standpoint, it's been pretty corrosive. Been married four times. I'm not proud to say that. And I think that a contributory to the breakup of those marriages was really the constant being on the road. I have five children by three of my wives, and the fact that they were with me on the road, by that I mean my wives, while we were just husband and wife with no kids. But once the kids came along, they properly stayed home to raise those kids, and that's when the troubles really began. I think you really have to be together, particularly in the case of the first of all my three wives prior to my current wife, Allie, really kind of retired from whatever they were doing, were just sitting in Beverly Hills in the house. Whereas Allie, of course, having been a lawyer, and she is a lawyer still, she had a very active life on her own, and so she had things to occupy her while I was gone.
You also met Allie at a different time, I think, in your life, when you had already gone through three marriages. Mm-hmm. You already were very successful. You were already comfortable with your success. We had talked earlier that you started in show business from age four. Mm-hmm. Were you comfortable with people coming over and asking for autographs and treating you like a star? Were you comfortable in the beginning?
I was comfortable in a certain way, from this standpoint, that I always loved being asked for autographs. I think it's very dear of people to want your name on a piece of paper or a book or whatever. I always get, and I still do get, very uncomfortable when people walk up and gush. And I know that it's done from love and it's done from admiration, and I really appreciate it. But, you know, I stand there sometimes and a guy will say, I've got every record you've ever made and you are just the best singer, and I'm going, thank you. And then it goes on and on and on, and I can't be rude about it, but it does make me uncomfortable.
Yeah, okay, and you know it's coming from love because...
Oh, absolutely.
And they don't know what to say to you because you're a star.
No. Actually, let me tell you how I feel about that word, Arlene. Gary Cooper was a star. Cary Grant, Clark Gable, Gene Harlow, Lana Turner, Ava Gardner. Those, to me, are stars. I'm just a working singer. I mean, I love being well-known. I'd be stupid if I didn't. But I don't consider myself a star, and I never have.
Well, I must say, being in the business for, we talked about it, over 60 years, that's pretty much, I would call you a star.
Well, I'll tell you something. A reviewer once said about me, when he said, gee, all this good stuff is happening for you now. This is not long ago. And he said, why do you suppose? And I said, well, I guess I'm a survivor. He said, no, you didn't just survive. You prevailed. Now that knocked me out. That was a better remark than any of these reviews that come along and say, oh, this guy was fabulous last night, or, you know, fantastic. Those overused adjectives, I think, are just exactly that, overused. But when a guy says you've prevailed, it means that you stuck to your guns, it means that you never sold out, which I don't think I ever have, and that what I wanted to do with my life, I actually did. It took a while, it took some periods of time that were not very pleasant, but you stick with it.
Okay, but in the course of, we were talking about three failed marriages,
mm-hmm.
Was part of it because of you being a star, even though you say you don't want the word star, but being a performer, being on stage all the time, did you feel that you needed a special kind of treatment at home that you didn't get?
Not really. I thought all three of my wives really put up with me, and not easy to put up with, because I've been known to fall into extremely depressed states of mind when the business, remember we talked on the previous show about when the rock and roll incursion happened and how that was depressing to me, who grew up with the big bands and Sinatra and all the great stuff. So I would get very depressed.
Okay, I want to talk about that because I think that's a very important point that you're bringing up, but we have to take a break and we'll talk when we come back.
Good.
We're speaking with Mel Torme here at Michael's Pub. We'll be right back after these messages.
Honey, it's Mom. Please let me in. I'm worried.
Learn to see the signs of mental illness. 2 out of 3 people who get help get better. For a free booklet, call the American Mental Health Fund.
A message from Ken McFeely, a police officer in New York City for 19 years. He was so respected, he was elected president of the Patrolman's Benevolent Association.
My name is Ken McFeely. Right now, I'm living under a death sentence. The doctors tell me that I have maybe 5 or 6 weeks to go because I have lung cancer caused by smoking. The danger that threatened my life as a policeman was sitting in that radio car and lighting up that cigarette. I'm 47 years old, and I'll never see 48. You face more danger with the 20 cigarettes that are in your pocket than any 6 bullets in somebody's gun. Cigarettes are a time bomb that you plant in your own life that explodes 20 or 30 years later. And you know something? You can stop it. If you stop smoking now.
Ken recorded this message for other smokers to hear before he died in October 1986.
Every day, we're losing 50,000 barrels of oil, over 2 million gallons of gasoline, to a seemingly unimportant thing. Low tire pressure. Have you checked yours lately? President Bush hopes you'll do your part. Drive smart.
Welcome back. We're with Mel Torme here at Michael's Pub in New York City, where I have mentioned that you have been packing them in. I have been here. The performances have been wonderful.
Thank you.
Here at Michael's Pub. But we talked earlier at the break. It's not always wonderful. You do now, but there was a period of time that you didn't pack them in, that there were times that maybe there were 12 people in the audience.
Mm-hmm.
How did you deal with that?
Not very well. Because I'd been in the business all my life, and it wasn't as if I had been a kid that went to high school and decided at the age of 17 or 18 that I would suddenly be in show business. I'd been a show business baby, I'd been a performer, I'd been well known as a child performer. So it cut deeply when I would go out there, and there, I don't think, I may have done shows with only 12 people, but certainly a minimum amount of people as opposed to a packed house like now. And I didn't handle it well, and I went into many fits of deep depression, which is incidentally, which I think, were contributory toward the breakups of all of the three marriages prior to the one I have now.
Okay, well, let's talk about the marriages. Because mm-hmm. your first marriage, you were young. You were in
22.
Hollywood. Okay, her name was Candy.
Mm-hmm.
Tell us about
Candy. Is a wonderful gal. As a matter of fact, we still are extremely friendly. She lives in California, and we talk. And she's a nice gal. She's remarried. She was married to Hal March, who unfortunately passed away. Who was incidentally a darn good father to the two children that Candy and I had together. Now, they never adopted him. I would never let that happen. But while they were living with Hal, he was terrific. So that was Candy. And then I was married to another lady by the name of Arlene Miles. That was a difficult marriage. It was very difficult. And that marriage came very close to shooting me down. But I survived it because I think God has a real good eye on me. And just as I was going through the turmoil of the breakup of that marriage, I met a very beautiful British motion picture actress named Janet Scott, whom I admired in movies many, many times. And I was playing in England. She came to see me. We dated. We fell in love. And a year later, when I was available to be married, when the divorce was final from Arlene, Jan and I married, and I thought that was really the idyllic marriage of all time. So you can imagine my astonishment 10 years later and two kids later when one day she called me. She was visiting her parents in England and said, "I'm never coming back. I don't like Beverly Hills. I don't love you anymore." You know, that one, more than anything else, really came close to really, really, really doing me in.
You know something, when you say you were astounded, when she called and said, "I'm not coming home," mm-hmm. I wonder if you really were astounded, because there are signals people give. In your book, It Wasn't All Velvet, mm-hmm. which was one of the five books that you have written, and you talked about that. You talked about how there were times you came home and she was despondent, she wasn't friendly. You knew there was something wrong. You didn't want to face it.
I think you're right. I mean, I think I wasn't being realistic about it. And had I opened my eyes more and been a little more realistic, I probably would have seen those danger signs, which I did not see. But it still came as a terrible blow. And again, in the midst of this madness that I thought I could never survive, bingo, there's Allie. And Allie and I met in court when I was in an action against my soon-to-be ex-wife. Allie was studying the law, and she was there for a legal aid problem. And to make a long story short, she handed me a slip, and I said, "What is this?" She just walked away, didn't say a word. And when I called her that night, because the slip, of course, had her telephone number on it, she said, "I saw you 7 years ago at the Sands Hotel in Las Vegas. It was one of the most joyous performances I've ever seen. And I saw you in that court corridor today, and you looked like you had lost your best and last friend. If you'd like to have dinner and talk to somebody, I'm available." We were never apart after that night.
Uh-huh. Oh, you lost a friend and you made a friend.
I lost a friend and I made a friend.
I have a quote from Mel Torme that I would like to read.
Mm-hmm.
It says, in relation to your relationship with women and your wives, "Any woman who becomes implicated in a marriage with an actor, singer, or comic usually finds herself saddled with a complex, self-centered, absent-minded, preoccupied, frequently tactless individual who needs constant care, feeding, and ego building."
I think that's true.
Okay, but was that you in your
sure.
marriages?
Absolutely. Because, the problems of being on the road, fighting the dragon out there, that's an old phrase. I mean, going out, fighting the competition, the dragons, the changing mood of the American public and the world public, indeed, you do need constant bolstering. I don't mean that every single minute, as you walk into the house, your wife has to say, "You are so wonderful, I can't stand it. You're beatific." Obviously not. But you do need to feel that there's one person, your wife, who, bang, is behind you 107%, you know. And that's very difficult for a woman to do. She's got her own ego. You know, she needs her own. I tried very hard, and I think I succeeded to some degree, to build the egos of my wives. But apparently I wasn't as successful as...
Okay. But you may have with Allie. One more quote before we take a break.
Okay.
From Mel Torme. "All my wives have been beautiful, but mm-hmm. I'm bad at picking women who are good for me. I am a perfectionist with a desperate desire to be super professional."
Mm-hmm. That's true. That's about, of course, my career, in other words, my performances. But I have been bad about picking women who are not necessarily good for me. It's that simple.
But you
learned. Except Allie.
Uh-huh, but you learned. And Allie is here.
That's right.
And we're going to take a break and talk some more.
Okay.
Because you've done so many things, and we're going to talk about some of the other things that you've done as well. We're speaking with Mel Torme here at Michael's Pub. We'll be right back after these messages.
Driving just 5 miles per hour slower than we usually do will save over 2 million gallons of gas a day and help keep America out of the red. Do your part. Drive smart.
Pete Sampras comes up to serve. John Stevenson makes the drive. A.C. Green and Charles Smith pound the boards. Marcus Allen rushes up the middle. Jay Schrader with the touchdown. There are a lot of different parts to play in the American Red Cross. Play your part.
This doesn't scare you. Just wait.
The doctor will see you now.
One night a year ago, Vanessa got high with some guy and forgot everything she learned about preventing AIDS. Now her life is the horror show. AIDS. Another way drugs can kill.
We're back. We're at Michael's Pub with my very special guest, Mel Torme. Mel Torme, who does everything. Mel Torme, who has been performing, as I mentioned earlier, your whole life. But, you know, you really are a terrific guy. I mean, I'm not saying this in terms of the way you live your life. I mean, you've had difficulty in marriages, but you've always been very upstanding. You're honest, you're sincere, you live a clean life.
Mm-hmm.
Now, in the music business, not so easy. I mean, now, unfortunately, drugs are a big problem. But when you started, I mean, drugs were around, smoking pot, smoking grass was always around musicians.
Mm-hmm.
How did you not become involved in that?
I didn't like it. It's that simple. I grew up as a child performer, and my parents didn't know the damage that sugar can do to you. So when I grew up as a child performer, every time I did a performance that they thought was a good one, I got a malted, or I got a chocolate bar, or I got a piece of cake or a pie. And so I developed a kind of a sweet tooth. I hated the taste of hard liquor, although I do like wine. I like good glass of wine with dinner. I've never smoked anything of any kind in my life. It's not necessarily a badge of honor. I just never have. And that's the way I've maintained a fairly, I think, pretty clean life.
Yeah, interesting, because being on the road, especially you at 16, you were traveling with a band. At 16, they were smoking pot. I mean, you really could have been, I mean, you were with your peers. How did you have the strength? I mean, you weren't with your peers, because you were with people who were so much older.
That's right.
And you would think that they would intimidate you, at least to trying it.
Well, part of it was thinking of my family, Arlene. I thought, if I ever did this, and I didn't really want to anyway, but if I ever did, they'd be pretty ashamed of me. And that's the way I was raised. So it was a natural thing. And believe me when I tell you that an awful lot of the guys in the Chico Marx band even said, yeah, don't be a square, don't be a dope. Have a little pot, man, smoke a little pot. Buddy Rich did that with me all the time. Buddy Rich constantly said, hey, what's the matter, man? Hey, take a drag, you know. I said, no, I don't want to, man.
I didn't.
I get high getting up in the morning and saying, gee, I'm still here. Another day above ground. Terrific, you know.
Terrific. Well, you stood on your own. Okay, now there was another time. Now, this is a sensitive subject, and I...
That's
all right. Okay, but it was in your book, so it's fair. Mm-hmm. Okay? Now, there was a time when you were at the Copa, when you were singing, when somebody came to you, the mob...
That's right.
...wanted to buy into your professional career. Mm-hmm. You said no. Now, a lot of people get broken bones for saying no. How did you avoid that?
I didn't get broken bones. I mean, they just made an offer that I could refuse, okay? And I did refuse, based on the fact that I was warned that if I did sell part of my, or my manager sold part of my contract with my acquiescence to the mob, that very candidly, they'd be able to tell me where to sing, what to sing, how to sing, who to date, you know, that kind of thing. And it was way too constricting in my mind. I'd always been a fairly free soul. And I felt that I could never, ever live that way, particularly musically. I felt that I could never have anybody say, don't be a wise punk, hey, you do what we tell you. And consequently, there was never even the beginning of a thought that I would ever give up part of my contract to guys who could run me.
But how could you say no? I mean, we have heard, we have read, terrible things have happened to people who have said no.
Well, actually, you know, I was at the Copacabana. It was my initial debut. It was all over the radio. People were playing my records like crazy. But, you know, who knew? I mean, it wasn't like I was a well-established performer or personality or celeb or indeed star, to use that word again, and have them say, hey, we want to take over a little piece of this guy. Because then maybe there might have been a little pressure. But there really wasn't. I'd love to make it dramatic, Arlene, but it wasn't dramatic. My manager, Carlos Gastel, asked me, and I said no.
Okay, well, you said no. You know, actually, as a joke, I said maybe you could have taken them to court. But what I'm talking about is night court. You have a whole new career, and I want to, with
Harry Anderson.
On night court. Tell us a little bit about what
that was. Well, Reinhold Riggi created that show, and he was a big fan of mine. And when he went to Harry to tell him that he thought it might be a nice running gag throughout the series, Harry thought he was putting him on. Said, who put you up to this? Everybody knows what a fan of Mel's I am. And so here were two souls met a night, and they decided, gee, this is going to be great because it's for real. So they started the joke, and for 9 solid years, I have been a running element on Night Court, and I just loved it. It's something you couldn't buy. You couldn't go to them and say, got an idea. How about me, Mel Torme? You know, and they said, what, are you kidding? Get out of here. But I was just lucky. It's just pure, dumb, blind luck that Ronnie was a great fan of mine, and so is Harry, and it's been wonderful for me. I'm doing 2 this year, and which I've never done before, and I may do the final one, which is, I'm sure it will be the final year. So I may be on the final one. So I may do as many as 3 this coming season.
Which is interesting, because it's a whole new audience. People who don't know you as a singer.
That's
I mean, there's a whole audience out there who don't know your drummer and all the, and your songwriting, and you're writing your books and all that stuff. They just know you as this legend.
A legend in my own lunchtime. Actually, the truth is that the best part of it has been that it has created a brand new, younger audience for me, because I see in my symphony dates that I do, in my concert dates, the jazz festivals, a great amount of young people coming to see me. Not just a smattering, not spattered here and there throughout the audience, but a solid gaggle of young people coming to see me, and it's all because of Night Court. I'm convinced of that.
Wow, that's been so much in your life. I read that you believe that there's a balance in life. For every positive, a negative. For every negative, a positive.
Absolutely.
Has your life been that way?
I think so. I mean, I think if I look at it on a balanced scale, that the bad has even, in a sense, been outweighed by the good. I mean, I really do believe that. I think I'm mercilessly lucky. I mean, just unbelievably lucky.
Well, I've been lucky, actually, and there's been a lot of good, because I've had you here all to myself, but today is your birthday. Mm. Now, I have a present for you.
So, it's a top.
Do you know what? Actually, I'm going to have to tell everybody what it is, because we talked about that you don't take drugs, and you mentioned earlier, chocolate. Chocolate. You're a chocolate junkie.
Uh-oh.
So if you promise to share...
I'm going to share this with my little group, my guys in the band, and give some to Gil Wiest, who runs Michael's Pub and who owns Michael's Pub. Oh, and I may have 1 or 2 or 3 or 4 or 5 or maybe 8, maybe 12.
Well, we could not let your birthday go by, and you also have given a very special gift to the world out there.
Thank
People
you.
Are not also aware. There's another gift, your songwriting, the Christmas song.
Mm.
We have Nat King Cole singing Chestnuts Roasting on an Open
Best
Fire.
Best record ever of it.
By Mel Torme. As we leave, we're going to play Nat King Cole singing Mel Torme's Christmas
Terrific.
Song.
Terrific. Mel Torme and Robert Wells, we wrote that together. So I didn't just write it alone. Bob Wells and I were a songwriting team. We wrote that song together.
Okay, but it's one of your best. Everything you do is the best. And it's been the best for me having you here.
Oh, pleasure.
And I thank you very much.
Thank you.
I hope that you have enjoyed the time we spent here at Michael's Pub with Mel Torme, and I hope you'll join me again next week. Meantime, good night. Hope to see you then.
To see if reindeers really know how to fly. And so I'm offering this simple phrase to kids from 1 to 92. Although it's been said many times, many ways, Merry Christmas to simple phrase to kids from 1 to 92. Although it's been said many times, many ways, Merry Christmas to you.